Greetings and welcome to RLM TV.
Amen. Welcome back.
Hope you guys are having a glorious day. We want to talk to you today a little bit about Dan, the judge. It is written in Torah that Rachel and her handmaiden gave birth to a son, and Rachel proclaimed that God has judged. And the word judged in Hebrew is Dan. The tribe of Dan is a tribe of lawyers. Now, we might cringe at that statement, or we might think, oh, nothing worse than a lawyer. Mm-hmm. Listen, man, that's not true. Okay? You had lawyers everywhere that were set up in Israel in the times of Jesus Christ because it was implemented by Torah. It was implemented by the very commandments of God given to his own people. Now, they have a bad rap because of abusing the law and twisting the law. Well, the very sacrifice of the Lamb of God in the Old Covenant, the sacrificial Lamb, in the New Covenant, Jesus Christ, the Lamb of God, was for the correcting of wrong judgments in the court systems of Israel. Now, if we look around in our nations right now, especially in the USA and New York City and elsewhere, we're going to see a lot of injustice and a lot of twisted, crooked activity going on in the legal systems. So this is why we're responding to the situation accurately from Torah as the ultimate guide from Jesus Christ to fix everything, because the original design of how God wants things to operate is the Torah. The Torah gives us our creation story. The Torah gives us the framework of how everything exists and how it came into being and how it should exist and continue to exist forever according to God's word. So we need to understand the tribe of Dan from Rachel, the mom of Dan, through the handmaiden. She was literally the mom and raised the judge and raised the lawyer of the tribes of Israel. She raised those banners. She raised those lawyers, and those lawyers in the New Covenant are like angel armies, and some of them are men and women as well. We have Christian men and Christian women and good Jews of heart in law firms and practicing law and attorneys at law all over the world, okay? So what it really represents now is a transition from the church age legalism or lawyer realms into the kingdom age, which is a far superior realm of law, and it's represented in Dan. And you might say, well, Dan's not represented in Revelation. I tell you the truth, that's not exactly what Revelation is talking about. You have 15 tribes, and all 15 tribes are glorified in Mashiach. So we're going to have to be open. One thing about Jewish wisdom is it's not right or wrong. That's a Greek understanding of things. In Jewish wisdom, it's like there's something right about all of these wise men of what they brought to the table. If there's 30 opinions of 30 different Jewish rabbis about something, they don't discount 29 and say only one's right. That's what Greeks do. Okay, that's demonic thinking. In Hebrew thinking, we understand that there's something right about all 30. Okay, no, it's a completely shift, a complete paradigm shift in our mindsets, but we need that. We need to be renewed in our mind because we got this black and white, and that's not how it works. It works in measurements, okay? Now, with demons, it's black and white because there's no redemption for demons, but you're not dealing with demons here. You're dealing with human beings. You're dealing with legal issues, and the demons will get obliterated anyway. A lot of times the demon just comes around and just amplifies the sin, the transgression, the magic spell, the sorcery, Laban the scholar demon, Balaam the evil eye, and so on and so forth. But when you obliterate all of that stuff that's not redeemable, you're still left with the humans. And so you're going to need law and order. Law and order is a wonderful thing. It's something we've often shrunk from in fear because we think, well, you know, it's going to really hinder my growth in Christ. I tell you the truth, you can't grow in Christ and not embrace the tribe of Dan. You cannot grow to a certain level of maturity in Christ and not embrace the lawyer tribe of Dan.
I have a great example I want to share. There was one of the young ladies who wanted to begin learning repentance and starting to study came across this instance. You know, when you're coming up from the lower places in society, You know, Jesus sees you as equal, right? We treat equally the rich man, equally the poor man, equally the blind, deaf leper at the gate, and the rich king over a city. In the eyes of Jesus, he sees a creation that needs salvation. So with that being said, the young lady, she had gone through this issue where she had this unpaid parking ticket. It was just basically an old mentality of not wanting to pay an unpaid parking ticket to, you know, so she couldn't go and park at the park or something, you know, along those lines. But the demonic reasoning that she'd encountered in her soul was she didn't feel like paying that because she knew the system is demonic. And so then it was like, that's just my way to kind of stick it to the system. But then she realized it was something she needed to repent of. So even though the systems that run society are overlorded by demons, there was still no glory given to God by having these outstanding charges for something like that. If you made a mistake, you didn't, you know, pay where you were supposed to park, and you get a ticket for that. And that's just a really good example of, you know, how we should be living our lives. Because what happens is when you have all those little things, those little issues come up. When you're coming from the lower ends of society, I mean, by that I mean maybe below middle class, upper class, Western United States society, those things can accumulate. Once those things start to accumulate, like you have a driver, you don't have a driver's license, or there's an issue with it, or it's difficult, you can't get a bank account, you can't, you know, pay your ticket, it accumulates and it builds and it builds and it buries you under all these limitations so that you can't even really be successful, you can't even really do anything in the kingdom other than just barely survive, barely get by. And why? It's all this kind of like weird avoidance of these just normal everyday things that most people who just are walking in the freedom and the abundance, you have the overflow that you can park at the parking meter to go, you know, to the park. And so you want to come out of the poverty. So I feel like the Lord is saying he wants to bring you out of poverty and into this overflow of abundance, where you're not afraid of, can I park here and can I go here? Am I going to get caught? All this weird stuff just to take your baby to the park. That's a life of bondage and fear. And it's a lot of financial trouble. Those little things, when they start to, it's like, oh, not a big deal. Well, the system's just demonic, so I just don't need to pay it. I'm spiritual. A lot of that is from the Gnostic. But a lot of that is the Gnostic demon that says, yeah, I don't have to deal with these issues.
But you do have to deal with it.
Anyway, so, and that's the thing. The only way to deal with it is what? Rise in righteousness. Be a good steward of your house. And just, you know, there's wisdom needed to navigate, because just knowing that the system is overlorded by demons doesn't mean that you not paying that parking ticket is going to do anything beneficial for your life.
It's rebels versus reformers. Now, this is something I had to learn the hard way, guys. Like, you have a born-again spirit in you, you know the red magic law of the wicked Bilum and the scholar demon are everywhere. At a city level, state level, county level, national level, all 16 branches. Everyone and their dog in the USA knows how crooked Joe Biden is. They call him Crooked Joe Biden. They know how crooked the system is. They know it's warped. But here's the difference. Here's wisdom. Here's the ladder. Rebel versus reformer. A rebel, the system still beats you. You lose because you're rebellious. Now the system beats you. The red magic law of the wicked Bilum and all of the crooked twistings of the law that are all just magic spells and sorcery spells in the USA, it oppresses the rebel. The rebel doesn't even have anything to do with that system. You know, you go into the ghetto, 95% of the gangs and the drug lords and the drug dealers, they don't even know anything about the laws. So you ask them any law in their city or their nation. I grew up amongst the gangs. They don't know any of them. You know, it's like it's just total lawlessness, it's called. So, but our response often, and we have all these excuses towards the man, and it's a rebel attitude. It's a rebel mentality. You have to get that out of you. There is a holy, righteous lawyer tribe of Dan, son of Rachel, okay? And this is the healing, the reformer. the reformer doesn't rebel. It goes through it and makes permanent changes that benefit everyone around you.
That's really good.
So we're going from rebellion to reformation. Reformation is the answer, not rebellion. We've already done all that. The drunken glory is the most rebellious thing in the history of the world for the greatest good and the greatest evil simultaneously. Now we're going to harness that energy, that power, that holiness, that Shekinah, that Kavod, the circumcisions, the wisdom of the ages, the mantling that God has put in us, and we're going to make reformation. No longer me against the system, kind of immaturity, you know, it's like... What's that rock band called? Rage Against the Machine? This isn't Rage Against the Machine.
Right.
Zach Delarucci, okay? Rally around the family with a pocket full of shells. This ain't that. Those days of immaturity, of being just a spiritual rebel, are over. It doesn't work. And in fact, the red magic of the wicked Balaam wants you to be a rebel because you can't really make a change. Even if you're out there parading, boycotting, and picketing, and doing all these things, they want you in the rebellion because then they can use the law against you. Here's how you change it. You go through the law with the tribe of Dan, with the angels of the tribe of Dan. Wave that banner, Dan. What's the flag of Dan?
Oh, yeah. It's the scale. It's the... Well, it's the there's a couple of things. Dan is a serpent, by the way. But it's also Gevra, Gevra, and it has to do with the law and justice. And we might look at some pictures.
All right, ready?
Yeah, let's look at the banners. We can talk about Dan a little bit.
Dan is a serpent. That's the serpent wisdom of the realm of the natural people. Be wise as serpents, wise as Dan, Jesus Christ, red letters. Amen?
Amen. And this...
And gentle as doves.
And gentle as doves, right? Don't go being ankle biters around each other. Just understand, okay, this banner vision, I want you to see these like flags waving because this has really blessed me. This picture of all those flags... There's an impartation whenever Brandon talks about the banners waving over us, the 12 tribes. I want you to see a vision of those banners flying over your life and know that this is where you belong. All right, you want to abandon all appearance and clinging to anything that clings to the enemy side. Their banners over you are not love, that's for sure. Their banners are terrible banners. So you want to be under these banners. You know, we have the 12 tribes, 12 apostles, and then also there's the 12 stars. And so we're continuing to learn on these things. But this is really wonderful. I want you to see that vision. Just see wherever you're at in your life right now. And just see these flags waving over you. And this is like an army, like a host, a bannered host.
Yep. It's reminiscent. These are bannered angels.
This is reminiscent to me of that Song of Songs reality of a mighty host with banners waving. And this is where we want to bring the bride into maturity. And you are the bride of Christ if you are betrothed to him. You are married to him. You love him. You want to be in the family of God. And so it's time to divorce Satan and all his ways, all his lies, all his flies, and really embrace these banners. It's, you know, we love the United States of America. We love the nations of the world. Those, you know, we want to redeem the people by bringing them to a knowledge of Jesus Christ within them, the hope of realizing the glory, and for him to return them to the Father. That's the goal. But when you think of your life and the banner that you're under, instead of just like United States flag and, you know, your own country's pride or whatever country you live in, you know, we have viewers from all around the world. So wherever you're watching from, it's nice you can share where you're watching from, but also looking at these flags. And now when you think of your country, your nation, your where you herald from, in your mind's eye of your spirit, I want you to see those 12 flags just waving brilliantly like a bannered host, armies of angel warriors, warrior tribes, scholarship tribes, those tribes who were doing well with finances, the business tribes. And what did they love to do? They loved funding the Torah scholars because it benefited all the tribes. Everything they did when they gave money, it was for a mitzvah. When the warrior tribes went to war, it wasn't just for themselves, it was for all these tribes to protect their nation, their people, right? So this is our nation, these are our people, the people who want to live in righteousness and have their being and move in Christ, not in thought, not just in imagination, but in reality, in the invisible and physical realities of righteousness through circumcision of heart. How did you know they were Jews? They were all circumcised. So who is a Jew among us? Those who are circumcised. Now, I know we have very few circumcised of heart people in the earth right now, but we have more people than ever who want to be circumcised of heart. And that is a thing to rejoice in. So we rejoice in that. If you are desiring to be circumcised of heart, you will be a part of this nation of cosmic Israel. And the Lord's banner over you is love. And it's the same power that raised Jesus Christ from the dead. And it's the same power of the Holy Ghost of Jesus Christ that raises up from the dead. It's a spiritual and moral resurrection out from the dead while yet in the body. It is written. And so let all other banners fade away. And let the banner over your life be cosmic Israel, circumcised of heart. Let's check this out. Exodus 31:2 reads in full, "See, I have called by name Bezalel, son of Uri, son of Hur, the tribe of Judah. Exodus 31:6 reads in full, "And I have set with him Oholiab, son of Ahisamach, of the tribe of Dan, and in the heart of all who are wise-hearted I have set wisdom, that they may make all that I have commanded you." The precise wording, "and with him Oholiab," appears in Exodus 38:23. Well, isn't this interesting? We have Bezalel. We know about Bezalel, right? We study him doing the working for the temple and putting things together. And it says, "I here have set with him Oholiab, son of Ahisamach, of the tribe of Dan." So the tribe of Dan has a hand in the building of the temple. What is the building of the temple in our day and age? It is that cosmic building up of the body of Christ. All right, and we got angels appearing in here. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Woo! That's bright. Angelic appearance flying overhead. That's nice. Thank you. And also, we just welcome all the holy angels in this broadcast, in this place, in your home. Let your holy angels assigned to you, those are set over you, be strengthened and refreshed by a fresh Shekinah. And may you be encouraged in your walk with the Lord, that no matter how far you have fallen, that there is a chance for redemption, that you can repent. That's that hope of repentance to a greater glory. And so that's what we're speaking over your life today in Jesus' name. So what's interesting here is we see that Bezalel, we all know, or most of us who have studied the Bible or have been taught Bible study by other people in the past, we talk about Bezalel, but look at this. Maybe if you went to Bible college to talk more about these things, I'm not sure, but Oholiab is of the tribe of Dan. And so we find here he has wisdom, and this imparted wisdom from YHVH is essential in the things needed for the temple, for setting up the temple or the tabernacle in the wilderness. And so the pattern, why do we interchange in this teaching tabernacle and temple often? It's because they are both the pattern, right? So the tabernacle is the pattern that Moses saw in the mountain. And it's the same pattern that was shown Solomon. We have angels flashing around here. It's the same pattern that Solomon was given for the temple. The only difference is the tabernacle is much smaller and it's temporary. It's like a tent. That's why the Apostle Paul, he was a tent maker. The Lord had a parable for his life, so he would make tents sometimes. It was about understanding. He would say, put off this garment like a tent. He would talk about his body, his skin. Right? And, you know, the skins for the tents were animal skins. And so there was an allegory there of, this is a tent. I'm in a temporary tabernacle. Until when? Until we put on the new garment. It talks about not taking off just the old, but being further clothed, additionally clothed. It's a really interesting New Testament study. I highly recommend you check it out. It's all about being clothed in the celestial garments, transfiguration of spirit, transfiguration of soul, and transfiguration of our bodies. And that's all biblical. And these are the kind of things that religious demons don't like you to find out about. But praise God, it's the truth anyhow. And we want you to rise up and walk in it. This is the path of transfiguration that very few have walked in since the beginning of time. All right, so that's the pattern. Tabernacle is the temporary. Temple is the eternal. And it's the one that goes up through the heavens. We are the body of Christ. Well, he's making this up of sapphire stones. Living stones. You are a living stone. How? If you are a burning one. If you are a living sacrifice, which is a burning one, which means all of your souls, daily, your mind, your heart, your bones, your blood, on the altar of the Holy Spirit, and fire, that's the altar of the Son of the priesthood of Michael. I pray that every day when I wake up, as soon as I can remember, I do that. It's life-changing. Highly recommend you start praying this because you want to start your day out being a living one, a burning one. And when we are a living sacrifice for the day, what does that mean? It means that we are a part of the temple. We're qualified as a burning stone, a sapphire stone. He's not using stones made with human hands, which means it's not our works, but the works that the Father has prepared for us, and that's to rise in righteousness. And so you go, you know, keep your eyes set to Keter on the ladder, so that engraved stone with his name, with a new name on it, you get a new name as you continue to rise. Now you're a burning one. You're a living stone of the temple of the body of Christ, and it's the pattern of Melchizedek. It's the pattern shown to Moses on the mountain. It's the pattern shown to Solomon and David for the temple. So this is important. So all of this is for wisdom. The Old Testament is for wisdom. That means it was a type and shadow of what God would be doing in the last days. So the full verse in Exodus 36 reads, Bezalel and Oholiab and every wise-hearted man in whom YHVH has given wisdom and understanding to know how to do the task of the holy works. So shall all that YHVH has commanded. So they shall do all that Yadevave has commanded. So what do we need to do the works to build the temple? In our day and age, we need wisdom and we need understanding. And mainly we need to be a burning one because he's building with living stones. So we trade the dead stone of the old ways, the dead way of thinking, the old nature whose fruit is death, the old tree whose fruit is death. We're trading that stony mind and stony heart, dead stones, in trade for precious stones, the sapphire stones, and it represents the body. When we talk about the left arm and the right arm being Gevra and Hesed, it's a map of the human body as well. But what are these two, what's this about Dan and the temple? This is something that came up today. Oh, here, let's see. Give me one. We are having a little. Oh, that's fine. is having a little technical difficulty with the picture, but I wanted to talk about Dan and Naftali. Today, Brandon made a really good point. This is a lot of glory on this today. When he said that the son of Rachel had included Dan in that. Mm-hmm. And that really, really struck me. And like, this is so true. There's a lot of wisdom there because it was through the handmaid. But the handmaid with that child, it was on behalf of...
Right, in that culture, mm-hmm. if your handmaiden had your child, mm-hmm. it was still your child. So Dan mm-hmm. is fully legitimately the son of Rachel, mm-hmm. 100%.
Amen. So maybe we can come back to us, I'll see if I can get this working.
Amen.
But yeah, that's just something that for the American mindset is... just a little different. It
That's
was not
really,
really
hard to imagine for us, some mm-hmm. other woman having your kid for you with your husband. So we can't even comprehend ancient mm-hmm. times, but it was God's command, and it was totally God, and that's how he worked it in ancient mm-hmm. times.
Okay, I think it's working now. Let's check it out. Okay. So Bilhah gave birth to two sons that Rachel named and raised. And those two are Dan and Naphtali. Now look at this. Dan is also associated not just with the snake, but with the law, the judge, as you were just talking about, the scale. So there's the balance of, you know, the justice scale of Dan and then Naphtali. We talk about, like, you know, the free spirit, the dance of the deer, the gazelle. And isn't this fascinating that Rachel named and raised them. So another way that this is what the Holy Spirit spoke to me to help me in my first world thinking, American thinking about Bilhah and Rachel. Think surrogate mother, you know, yeah. With the technology that we have now, there's, you know, you can have a surrogate mother, but back then they didn't have the technology. So this is kind of like an ancient way of doing that, and you can see too with like levirate marriage, where if a brother had died and he didn't have offspring to carry on the family name, that the another brother in the family would be asked to perform that duty so that the family name could continue. And so just understanding that their values and society was much different than it is today, but God had given them a law so that they wouldn't be a part of the barbarism of some of those nations that God literally had to destroy with fire because it got so out of control. And when you read some of those records of how bad it was in Jasher and in Jubilees and just in history, it was pretty bad out there.
Yeah, he's going to destroy and annihilate nations again in these days, but these nations are called the nations of the red magic of the wicked Balaam. That is truly the Kelopot enemy, and all Jews of every synagogue on planet Earth right now are praying for a Mashiach to deliver them from the Kelopot.
Wow.
Understand the wisdom of the Jewish Messiah that we really don't have in Christianity right now, we need it restored, is salvation from a certain thing. It's from the red magic of Balaam, from the red magic of Laban, and their Kelopot, which is Satan and his angels, and they know all of their names, they're studied, they're written in Torah, all of their spirits are very, very apparent in the Kabbalistic interpretation of Torah, which is the highest level of understanding of the scriptures that we need to have in these days to be relevant against our enemies. Just a basic understanding of scripture is not going to do a dent in the spiritual world. But the higher our understanding is, the more dense and the more destruction will do to the Kelopot. So we need to understand that we are waging the good Christian warfare against the red magic nation. It is a nation of red magicians. They use white magic and black magic as well. Jesus Christ says the same thing in Revelation, that they are outside the city gates who practice all the magic arts. These are all the sorceries. It's not drugs and alcohol. It's not pharmakia. It's that wicked Balaam. Yeah. It's that wicked Laban. It's the 10 forms of Laban's sorceries written in Torah that they tell you that list of necromancy. They tell you that list of sorcery, divination, augury. And it goes on and on and on. There's 10 total forms. And Laban gave birth to Beor, gave birth to Balaam. And Balaam was also seen in Nabal, who tried to destroy King David, and was again seen fully in Judas Iscariot. So it's absolutely a New Covenant thing. And we read about that wicked Balaam in the epistles of our apostles in the New Testament as well. So this has not been destroyed. This is truly what the Messiah being formed in us, born again believers filled with the Holy Spirit, is to do in these days. It's not to go out here and just do Christian works. That is a distraction. That is a delusion. That is a dead work. We are to complete mitzvahs and seek holiness. We need to get back into the Jewish wisdom of our Jewish Christian religion and understand the holiness that was first imparted through the Messiah and the apostles of the Lamb, because we've departed so far from it. And when we do, we will begin to do the works that please the Father, like it says in Revelation 2 and 3. So we get rewarded with a greater power, a greater authority, in order to do damage to our last enemy, which is the red magic of Balaam and the Kelapot, which is what we see in all U.S. politics right now, going crazy, hurting good people, hurting people that are trying to help everyone. That's the Kelapot. We're at total war against the Kelapot. You can call it the deep state. It's not the deep state. The accurate term from Torah, because Torah wisdom is what we need to destroy our spiritual enemies and natural enemies, is Kelapot. And their ultimate power is red magic. And so as you grow in the Mashiach, this stuff will be obliterated, but you are not to face this on your own in the sand, because you'll just be incinerated. You are to obey God in the mitzvahs he's commanded you in the sand. Okay, we're all sandworms, which means we have nefesh souls that are in the blood. And when we obey God's commandment, he moves us into the cave of treasures, which is where we cocoon, so we can metamorphosize as butterflies from rung to rung on Jacob's ladder, which is the ladder of Jesus Christ. John 1:51, Genesis 28. Now when we go up the ladder, that is the only potential place to do permanent damage to the Kelapot and all the red magic that we are predestined, foreordained to obliterate in this generation. Then you'll have reformation in every single aspect of military, political, and economic life. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. That's really good wisdom. And I have some wisdom I wanted to share about this picture, but I also wanted to share a little wisdom on how we can be reformers instead of just being rebellious, because as we've already established, just being a rebel because you know that the enemy has taken ground in the natural dimension doesn't advance the kingdom. It doesn't help you at all. It just makes the gospel of Jesus Christ so inaccessible to people who need to hear it. Because when you're a rebel, it for most people, they cannot receive the gospel from you because you're a rebel. And that does a lot of harm to the kingdom. So at that point, you're harming the harvest of the kingdom. So when we choose to be rebellious instead of walking in righteousness and reformation, that's when we do damage to righteousness, when we do damage to wisdom, because we're not walking in wisdom. We're just, again, saying, oh, well, it's just demonic, so, you know, I'm just gonna not go to that park anymore or not park my car there or something, you know, the details of whatever situation it might be. It's the that whole mentality that has to burn on the altar. So instead of saying, well, I'm not submitting to this demonic principality, you know, the park ranger is just a normal person who's just trying to get by and do their job, and probably has a family, he might have kids, and he that's a job that he could get, or the one that was there for him, and that's what he does. And so you find that the majority of people in a system that's demonic are very much, you know, victims of it too. And so just making it harder for the people in line at the grocery store, you know, because you don't want to wait in line or whatever, or just making things difficult and getting yourself into trouble in all kinds of ways to do what? Because a lot of those decisions are usually made out of fear and paranoia. People don't want to be on a record somewhere. You know, they don't even want to give their accurate, you know, birth date at the bank. Or just making, you know, you don't want to, just all this really fear and paranoia based, the way you save your passwords, the way you do. Now you want to be wise and have all your stuff in order. You want to make sure you lock your doors at night. You know why? We live in a wicked world. Like, I've met people before where they thought it was an act of faith to just keep their doors unlocked as if it made them higher spirituality. I was like, no, this is actually a really dumb thing to do. Like, we do need common sense. Lock the doors. Why? Because the strong man, you know, they talk about a thief coming to steal, and you want to have at least, you know, you don't create opportunities for demons. That's what I'm trying
to say.
Give
the enemy no foothold, it is written, which means close the door.
Yeah.
And that handle of the door is written in Song of Songs. You don't want it open to the night watchman.
Mm-hmm.
You want it closed and sealed and deadbolted. You don't live in fear, but you have law and order. Understanding you are on the earth in the worst situation of Babylon the Great, where everything really is, you know, created to kill the human being from birth through drugs, alcohol, pornography, all the sexual morality, all the wrongdoing, all the lies, all the brainwashing.
Mm-hmm.
And it is absolutely intentional from the fallen angels to destroy every human life. Amen. So we come out of all of that by protecting ourselves by putting on the Word of God. The Word of God is our only salvation.
Mm-hmm.
There is no other rock other than our rock, the rock of the Word of God that we build this house of the kingdom of heaven on. And unless the Word of God is building up your heart, your mind, and becoming your protection, well, we need to learn how to use the Word of God, not just the Word of God in the mouth of an infant in Christ, because it's goo goo gaga. It doesn't do anything. But the mature Word of God spoken out of a voice of a circumcised heart and mouth, which is a mature Jewish man and a mature Jewish woman, that's when the Word of God goes forth and does awesome damage to the angel of death, which is really your ultimate enemy in this time, overcoming and conquering death, the last curse to be swallowed up in victory. So we understand more accurately through a circumcised heart, mind, and mouth how to speak God's word to destroy the enemy, to destroy the red magic, the kelapot, the wrongdoing, the magic arts, the sexually immoral, those who love lies. We are to annihilate that stuff with the sword of our mouth. Revelation says, I am coming to destroy what? Wickedness with the sword of my mouth. Now he's talking to believers there. Mm-hmm. How much more in common sense Jewish wisdom is that for the unbelievers? Hebrews says the same thing. So we need to apply that like a thousandfold to the wrongdoer, to the wicked, to the one who practices adultery, who practices murder, who practices stealing and twisting of Torah and twisting of the scripture. That wicked Balaam and that scholar demon that are always twisting the things of God for the fallen angels against Israel and against the circumcised of heart, the born-again believer. So that is your ultimate showdown. This is the climax of the ages, the maturity of the times, and God is going to equip us to be victorious over all of it. And in fact, the wrestling, even though it might be sorrowful, meanwhile wrestling this horrible, nasty red magic arts and these horrible scholar demons and Balaam demons and the kelapot is so filthy and disgusting. It is a permanent breakthrough for the generations to come. No one's going to have to deal with this stuff after we obliterate it in our generation. We need to stand up and deal with reality, not as rebels, but as mature reformers, not going around the system. Now, the angels confirmed this to both of us clearly. We do not go around America. We do not go around our city, our county, our state, our federal. We don't go around any of it. We go through it. And by going through it, you bring permanent reformation. That's why it's written, you will live in houses you did not build, which means you're not going to demolish the houses. This is the building of cities. Mm-hmm. You're not going to demolish cities. You're not going to demolish Washington, D.C. You're not going to demolish New York City or Los Angeles. You're going to go through these cities and bring reformation. And that is how God's legal order of the tribe of Dan with the banners of the lawyer angels are going to change things. It's going to be a higher law, a better law, a greater excellence. It's going to shame the scholar demon. It's going to shame the red magic Bilum sorcerer in politics and in Disney and all these pedophiles at Nickelodeon and all these people being exposed in Los Angeles. It will shame them. It will remove them. It will judge them. Dan, the judge of them. Now, we can't be the judge. The problem is the Christian, the born-again believer, is often self-anoints and self-appoints to be the judge of everything. If we do that, we disqualify ourselves from actual any reformation or any true judgment that comes from God. You can't have God as a judge and you as a judge at the same time. And you can't say, well, a spiritual man judges all things. He's speaking of the Holy Spirit through the spirit of man. Judges all things. The born-again believer is not the judge. Well, I will appoint some of them to be judges, that is right. Some of them to be Dan. Understand me now. Be very, very clear and concise. I want you people to understand this clearly, that the judgment seat of Christ is the only judge at every level of sand and star of Abraham, in whom the world was created for. The world was created for Abraham, and the world was created for Israel. And you are members of the cultivated olive tree of Israel only if you're circumcised of heart and obedient to the angelic commandments coming down in the hierarchy of the rungs of Jacob's ladder, Jesus Christ's ladder, which is the ranking system of the order of Melchizedek.
Amen. And that's such a good point, and that leads me right in to what we want to talk about here with this picture, that's such a great point. It's a cultivated olive tree, right? It's not a wild tree. You came maybe from a wild tree, but we're engrafted into a cultivated olive tree. And so the cultivated olive tree, it has no rebellion. It has the fullness of the authority of Jesus Christ being made manifest in the bride of the kingdom age. And so that's what we want you to step into, is that maturity, which is through the circumcisions of heart, rung by rung of Jacob's ladder, beginning with Malkut on those four levels. But here, when we talk about reformation, so how do you go through the system and reform it? This is how it's only possible, and I want you to be very understanding of this point, especially if you are one of our, you know, long-time followers. You're a scribe of righteousness. You're taking notes. You're a scholar of righteousness. You are one of the Zedekim. If that's you watching this, you probably want to include this in your notes, because this is very important. How do you go through the system and not just get destroyed by it, because it is meant to destroy you? But how do you, you know, you can't just run away and be a rebel. How do you do it? You have to walk in righteousness. If you're not walking in righteousness, it will destroy you.
Yeah.
If you're walking in rebellion, it will destroy you.
Truth.
It's only a temporary escape. It doesn't really do anything, and it'll actually destroy you harder if you do get into rebellion and you don't repent. So we have to walk in cosmic righteousness. That's the only thing that brings the judgment upon the wicked system itself, because their wicked system is built on the kelapot. And until there's someone at the heights, until we have the people that are rising up into the heights that will be at the same height or higher than in true righteousness, what the kelapot have in their unrighteous system that destroys believers, that persecutes and attacks the people and preys on the weak and preys on the poor, and it preys on those people who want to do the right thing. It really just attacks and destroys them. So how do we do this? You have to get righteousness. You have to be circumcised of heart. You have to go from Malkut to Yesod, Yesod to Hod, and to, I'm almost saying the tribal names out of my mouth. I don't know which ones they are, but it's almost coming out of my mouth. because the Lord knows what their, you know, banners and their walls and everything. And then, you know, Venus, Nutza, and then Tiferet, and keep going, right? You have to get the transfiguration of spirit and the sun, because that's the spirit of the righteous. And then when you're like the angel standing on the sun, and you're transfigured and your form is forever changed, that's when you begin to get that lightning energy of Shekinah working in your innermost being. Now you've got a lightning ruah. So your innermost being at that point, when you have a ruah spirit baptized in the Holy Spirit and then ascended into the sun with thorough circumcision of each rung, not one missing. If you're missing one of them, it doesn't matter how long you stay in the sun, or if you get to the sun and you go back, you know, people got into the sun, got in the Klippeth and had to go back. Why? Because even if you get in the sun or above the sun, if you don't have exact thorough circumcisions, it will literally never happen for you. You could wait for 50 years, it'll never happen. You have to have exact thorough circumcisions of each rung. And that's why we teach it so thoroughly and accurately for the last year and a half. And we hit on these points again and again, because we know as students, it takes time. So for your notes for this tribe of Dan, and justice and bringing reformation to all areas and realms of society.
Yep.
We have to walk in righteousness. You can't really do this until you walk in righteousness. But some of those of you who are getting, I see it in our comments today, some people are repenting. Go ahead and, that's a mitzvah for you to go ahead and repent and take care of those things. Those little loose ends, those little legal loose ends that you guys have.
It's important.
You have partial circumcision on Malkut, and you're washed by these words. So go ahead and fulfill and take care of those mitzvahs that the Holy Spirit is convicting you, and follow up on those. That'll be really good.
I have some wisdom about why the serpent was the banner and the flag of the tribe of Dan in Israel. It's because of serpent wisdom. It was the implementation of the Torah law against the accusing attorney nations, against the accuser. So Jesus Christ says, be wise as serpents and gentle as doves. So what is the wisdom of serpents? It's how to use Torah in the realm of the natural for the benefit of whatever you're representing. So we know lawyers represent someone. Well, the tribe of Dan is the lawyer that protects the Israel of God. It protects the bride of Christ. It protects the Shekinah. It protects the glory, the ark, and the tabernacle. It protects everything God's built. And so we need this implemented around all Israel and around all the flags and tribes of our Christian belief systems right now. Otherwise, as we look in our society, they are getting harmed so severely by the red magic lawyers of the Kelapot. Well, with Dan activated now, and we are speaking that into existence, we activate the banner, the myriads of Zion, of the lawyers of Dan around the bride of Christ, around Shekinah, around the tabernacle of Jesus Christ's mercy seat, around the tribe of Levi, which is what I am, you know, and as a full-time minister, and around everyone who's a believer in Jesus Christ, all 12 tribes. Zebulun's going to need Dan. Every single tribe will need Dan. And so these are your Holy Ghost-filled, sanctified, anointed, angel-appointed, mitzvah lawyers of Israel, and they need to be all around the 12 tribes in order to use that serpent wisdom to protect what God is doing and building, to protect God's finances, to protect God's houses, the tents. Like, you know how the legal system works. If you don't have good representation as a lawyer, they can come take your house, they can come take your bank account, they can come take your children. I've been in full-time ministry almost 20 years. We've seen them take people's children and take people's houses, everything. But if you have Dan, they ain't taking nothing. In fact, they won't even come close to you. I mean, this is better than any Manhattan law firm. You have myriads. Dan is myriads of lawyer angels of Mount Zion, of the throne of God the Father, the Almighty. And believe it and receive it and really get obedient to the last mitzvah that the angelic hierarchy commanded of you, and you'll be right in the center of the 12 tribes where you need to be protected and blessed and making progress in your walk with Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen. Now, I want you to imagine these two here, Dan and Naphtali. There's wisdom here. Rachel's sons. What do we know about Rachel's offspring? Well, the two that she birthed from her own womb are considered to be more righteous than the others. So we understand that Rachel really does represent righteousness. And in her righteous offspring, she was the one that was ordained to be with Jacob. That's the sun and the moon. So when you have Tiferet and Shekinah unified, that's the Shekinah connection of the 12 tribes is the restoration of righteousness. So yes, all 12 are considered, biblically and angelically, heavenly, all the tribes of, the 12 apostles, the 12 stars of the bride of Christ standing on the moon, clothed in the sun, crowned with 12 stars, all 12 of those angelic tribes are righteous. So when you look on the left-hand side here and you see Dan, we see Dan and we see Naphtali. What we see here is a picture of Rachel naming and raising them, which she was symbolic of Shekinah. So we're seeing raised up by Shekinah in your life at home watching right now. You need Dan, you need the judge. And on the other hand, you need Naphtali, you need the free spirit.
The free spirit.
And these two work together. These two were raised through Bilhah as like the surrogate mother, basically, Dan and Naphtali, think of this as a balancing scale. If you have way too much Naphtali, and not, oh, I see an angel flashback there, yeah. Bam, sapphire stone.
Very important.
If you have all the free spirit in the world and the fun and the personality and you're leaping around like a gazelle, that's really amazing. But if you don't have any Dan working in your life, oh, they're going to take advantage of all the tribes.
Yep.
So Dan is protecting the tribes in the way that he knows how to. And we need that activated in your life. So just receive that angelic activation. Let the angel tribe of angelic warriors and legal angels, holy angels of the holy heavens who serve and love Jesus Christ today, who love him and serve him, who serve the people of God, let them be released to you now and to RLM Global, those of you who are genuine in heart, who are desiring and seeking with a pure heart righteousness through circumcision of sapphire stones. Be activated in the lawyer tribe of Dan, in the judge. God is your judge, which means what? We're going to the Father's courts only. The Father is your judge only, and not the angel courts of the fallen angels with accusers. In Jesus' name. So there'd be a protection of the banner of Dan. I want you to see Dan's banner flying over you, the angelic corresponding tribe to the 12 tribes, and let that be activated. So now if you get really, really serious and really illegal, or if you get really into Dan, and let's say like really into Issachar, you're only in Dan, it might get out of balance. So I want you to look at this and see this. And they disappeared. Wow. this thing is funny today. They're invisible. Look, you can't even see them. It's on my computer. But who knows? So I want you to see it like a balancing scale. On one side, you have Dan. And the other side, you have Naphtali. And in this picture, they are evenly balanced. What does that mean? You want these evenly balanced in your life. We want to have both, and in reality, we want to have
this is the front lines, 12. Isn't it, Rebecca? You feel it today?
This is this really like is. the greatest anointing? And the great, they say they. I remember, people talked about it, and I heard some people talk about it before I got to the front lines. They said that the glory is the best at the front. And I believe it. And what's cool is we're watching this picture of there's a we have a nice little background music playing. By the way, I recommend we don't do music because of during the show because there's a lot of copyrights on YouTube. But we like to have a little background music. So I do recommend when you're watching the show live, put on some soaking music, some lo-fi, some what do you like, jazz music? What do you guys like?
I love lo-fi.
What kind of music do you guys
Lo-fi
like?
Lo-fi study music.
Some like non-vocal.
Background. Mm.
Yeah, some like instrumental or without vocals.
Instrumental.
Instrumental music. What kind of instrumental music do you guys leave in the comments? What's your favorite? What do you listen to? What is it? Tell us. You know, we want to know about you.
Yeah.
And we're watching this one. With this one, it's a beautiful picture of Jesus.
Free spirit music.
Yeah, Naphtali for days.
Everyone's got some of that. Amen.
Get the Naphtali music. Go and do leaps and jumps. Man, there's so much revelation here. But the picture that we have of Jesus, he's in a rose garden, and there's this glory of the sun blazing, and there's a neon pink butterfly and a neon green butterfly.
Amen.
And I'm like, hey. And in his left hand, he's holding a pink rose.
Us, yeah.
The butterflies.
Right there.
Yeah. And he's holding a pink rose in his left hand.
Just and document the sign and wonder for
yeah,
everyone.
Document, yeah. Document.
Yeah, we're live. Here we go.
Yeah. Just take a picture. So cool. You get those butterflies. And So understanding too that Naphtali isn't really the opposite of Dan, even though in some ways it is, because this is something you need to know. When you are dealing with legal issues, if there are divine decrees that are against you from the Satans, one of the best ways that the sages have taught us in the oral tradition of Moses to mitigate those decrees is through praise and dancing, and so moving your feet, dancing in praise, and hand clapping.
Yes.
And I know somebody's gonna witness, you're the hand clapper. If you're the OG hand clapper at home, like the praise and the dance, you got the clapping. You got the clapping going on. Just leave that in the comments. Let us know who you are. And just clap away. In the praise, what that does, because the body, the human body is made in the image of the temple of God, which is in, we are made in his image. He's trying to give us hints about his areas of like compassion and his balancing scales, his wisdom, his understanding. It's a very deep, rich mystery of wisdom and love. And so Naphtali is not really the opposite of Dan. Like one's just stuffy and one's just woohoo, just kind of a little too flying free. They need each other. So when Dan's doing the groundwork, writing up, you know, their documents, signing them, getting it done in the intercessory, you know, prayer, and just making sure everything gets done like that, making sure it's justice for Yadevave, not justice for Klippeth sorcerers. That's insane.
Mm-mm.
That needs to be put an end to, but it can only be done in cosmic
Cut
righteousness.
Cut them down, angel armies.
The wisdom of the dancing deer. Think Song of Songs, final chapter, divine duet,
I'll
dancing
demonstrate.
On the heights.
I'll make a short video, show you how to do the gazelle.
Seriously?
I have a gazelle anointing.
He does. It's the best thing. It's one of the most anointed things you'll ever see. Yeah. And literally,
he makes my feet like the feet of the hind.
On the heights.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, yeah.
And that's powerful, man.
It's really powerful. So dancing in the anointing, especially when you feel the heaviness, if you feel the warfare, the battle, and if you don't feel like it, oftentimes you just need to get and put on some praise music and get up and just move your feet. You may feel heavy at first, but as you move your feet and clap your hands, it's about the sephirotic body, the sapphire stones. When you're doing that and you praise God, continue to praise him and dance before him and pray for those divine decrees against you to be mitigated. You can tell there's a measuring scale.
Yeah.
Is the more joy that you feel when you're doing that, because at first you're not, you may, if it's a lot of warfare, you're not going to feel very fun and
feel
free,
like tightness and
fear and
paranoia,
weird and all that.
That's the caliber.
So say
he
your prayers and do that, and then put on the praise, put it in the hands of God, and just dance before the Lord. Clap and just sing and shout, stir up the oil of joy. Praise always leads to victory, and just dance.
You know,
and
one thing that I've noticed too, I mean, you do need to praise, you do need
mm-hmm.
to sing, you do need to dance. These are all written in the scriptures mm-hmm. of the Psalms. This is a part of our faith walk. But you will also sometimes only get the breakthrough when you engage the word into your eyes
yep.
and it consume your senses. I have found the most powerful breaker anointing for any kind of Kelepot attack, which is Klippeth attack,
mm-hmm.
any red magic scrolls or accusations or legal decrees of the Satans against you, you take it to the Torah scroll of Enoch and watch Enoch shred it like a
mm-hmm.
fish.
Amen.
I mean, it doesn't even typically take 10 minutes, and yep. Enoch just shreds it like a fish.
Amen. So, you know, they have a story in the oral tradition that David was approached by the angel of death at different times. And what he was doing was he was engaging in Torah. And as long as he was engaged in Torah, that angel of death couldn't touch him because he couldn't be killed because he was literally studying the Bible every time the spirit of death tried to come and kill him. Mm-hmm. And then he was adoring Shekinah and the midnight praise with the harp and all that.
Burning the midnight oil.
Oh, yeah. So, but he would engage in Torah. So if you want to prevent. Whoa. Yeah.
My apostle finger just started going wild right now. Nice. And that's Malkut. Glory.
Amen.
There's so many signs and wonders
it's
in
like
the
constant,
Shekinah.
Yeah.
It's pretty wild.
We love it. So, yeah, Enoch has been, so we have one of our students at the top of Malkut has been watching Enoch for the past 3 days. Yeah, we've been into Enoch too lately.
Wow.
Yeah, so it's cool to see the synchronization.
Cool.
There's a lot of that there. Enoch really increases the Shekinah manifestation. So here's the deal. When you need to up your armor and keep the Satans away, remember, an hour a day keeps the human away. What is the human? What is human? Earthly? Spiritual? Unspiritual? Sorry. Demonic?
Yeah, it keeps the
earthly,
sin out.
Human? Unspiritual? Demonic? So an hour of Torah per day keeps the human fallen angel nature away.
Amen.
Amen. So when you need to put to death the flesh, pretty much every day you just got to put Bible into the eyes.
Man. This thing is so slow and dull. No matter how many souls you have, this thing is like just like a slug you're dragging. But it becomes clear, and it can cooperate with your higher wisdom.
Amen. Amen. And what was it? Oh, yeah. And if the decrees, so that's what you want to, is really preventative. It can also soak and heal you if you've been wounded in your soul or your invisible body. You've been hurt in your spirit. Engaging in Torah, that's why we encourage, do like some soaking, calm music, spa music, something, harp. The harp is powerful.
Harp's good.
Put your hand on your spirit.
Any of those Jesus meditation videos on YouTube with soaking music, even if it's got a lotus flower, don't be offended by the lotus flower. I know some of you look at the lotus flower and be like, oh, I can't watch this Jesus. That's a false Jesus. Man, there's more Jesus usually in that peaceful video of him holding 7 candlesticks and floating through space than a lot of places you'd go that call themselves church. So that soaking is really important. It's really powerful. And we need to soak. We need to heal. We need to bathe in the pools of the upper Garden of Eden. They do come down, and the angels will bring that stuff down to you as you're making progress, even in your infant walk. So it's not like just you have to be this perfect 25-week Enoch, and it's like to experience God. You experience God from birth, and the angels are with you bringing God to you like a one who's a suckling, a nursling, and you're being nursed of God in your infancy. We have this delusion that, oh, it's so terrible to be in the sand. You know, it's so terrible to be on the earth. I'm in hell. I'm such a reject. I'm so bad. I'm so bad. No, listen, man. It is a wonderful thing to be a suckling of God. It's like being of the 12 tribes. It's the exact same thing as being a young patriarch or a young member of the tribes of Israel. Okay? You are raised on the best things of heaven. The least in the kingdom of heaven is better than the greatest prophet in the Old Testament. Jesus Christ said that. And it's true. As long as we have that attitude where I'm being fed by God and I'm making progress to God, I'm obedient to God, you'll have the best thing of the higher realms every day as you go towards the cross and you go towards the cave of treasures. And here is one of the biggest things that we need to rediscover and unearth in these days. School of the Magi. School of the Magi and the Glory Life by RLM app.
Oh yeah, some people are sleeping on that.
I've been thinking that it was the freshman year course of Masterclass. I've been recommending it for like 2 years.
And
that's
should be
only for
too.
The people that are already cosmic. Those are for people already on the moon and the sun and the stars who are already ascending the ladder. But the School of the Magi that's only available when you create a login account in our app, links in the description, that you have all the notes of School of the Magic. Guys, I just found this out today. This is how slow my nefesh is. I've been telling people masterclass, freshman year masterclass, they'll never get to the sun if they're just masterclass. From earth to moon is School of the yep. Magi. All the nations need School of the Magi, and everyone who's studied and gone through and obeyed the instructions in the School of the Magi, which I went through as well and obeyed, has gone cosmic. 100% success. It works. It's yep. directly from Enoch.
Yes, so that's really good. Yeah, the School of the Magi is, if you want to be cosmic, start there. If you're on, if you're a Malkut dweller, you know, the blue sea people. You want to head to Skypiea.
It's a member of the 12 tribes scattered throughout the yeah. sands of the earth. Yeah. And you are precious to the Lord. And the consecrated messenger, Rebekah the Apostle, which is accurately her office. That means that message from God is to help the scattered Jews of heart throughout the nations make their way to the Cave of Treasures to inherit the ladder in these days.
Yeah.
And it's absolutely going to work for you. Get a login and see those notes, read those notes, yeah. obey those notes. You'll all find the ladder soon enough. Truth anyhow.
Amen. So with the School of the Magi, you get the app, you log in. If you click on the little hamburger, there's School of the Magi. If you don't know what the hamburger is, it's the little three lines for the menu, little side menu that pops up. It's on iOS. It's on Android. Now, you could go through the masterclass, and you should, because that has all the details about how to survive in space, essentially, how to survive in the second heavens.
Yeah.
You're gonna need that.
Yep.
And even if you're not there, it's really wise to start taking it, because the Lord was talking to me about this today, or the Holy Ghost on the inside like a river. We were talking about the masterclass as well. And, I was asking, well, should they also take the masterclass? This is what he was talking to me about as well, is you should go through the masterclass if you haven't, because let's say you take the School of the Magi and you go cosmic, and then you get there, and then you have no idea what to expect. And you don't know what the enemies are like, and the enemies are within yourself, right? It's everyone their own soul. That's what Malkut is, Nefesh. That's all the Nefesh. And the Nile is in the blood. That's the bloodstream, and the Nefesh is in the blood. And so until that goes up and gets purified.
Drink of the blood of Jesus.
Blood transfusion. Yes, Lord.
Dense does that Ruth Heflin have another drink?
Yeah, so what am I trying to say here? What the Lord was talking about is you want to know what to expect before all of a sudden you're in the cosmos and you have no idea what you're doing. They don't send astronauts into space just not knowing what's going on. That could be rough. Because people kind of, it's very humbling. You guys can witness.
Like Inception or something.
You guys can be a witness. Those of you who are already cosmic, how humbling it is when you get to the second heavens. It's humbling. You're like, oh, I thought I knew something on the earth. And then you get there and everything's like, it's completely different. It's a totally different ballgame.
Yeah.
It's totally different.
It's amazing.
But it's biblical. And the whole Bible starts to make sense once you go cosmic.
The ladder is the only thing that matters.
Yeah. Amen. And so where it comes to School of the Magi, so that's what the Lord wanted to say today about the School of Righteousness
for
Masterclass.
For all the buckwheat scattered throughout the sand, you need the School of the Magi to understand.
And those of you who are getting ready to go to the 10th week, which is like one student in the world, but I mean, you're going to get there. Maybe some of you will be there next year.
She's preaching to me right now.
I guess I could.
Amen.
Well, because I know people are going to watch this. I trust that people are going to watch this video.
Amen.
There might be like 10, 15, 20, or 100 people watching this video someday who are right there, and they're like, I need this wisdom. Come
yes.
on, Nureka, tell us.
We need it.
Because you want to get a pink
help,
rose,
Lord.
Right?
Then he still sends Rebekah.
Because you want to get a pink rose. You want a red rose. You want a white rose. You want a pink rose. You want a red rose. You want all the roses. Come on, let's get all the roses.
Amen.
Why not? What else are you going to do with your life?
Nothing. I'm
pay
just
your
gonna
park
go,
ticket.
Going to go up the ladder and do mitzvahs
get
and
your
seek
baby's
holiness.
Birth certificate.
That's all I'm doing forever.
Yeah.
I love it.
So, yeah, it's good. And we do the mitzvahs below with our bodies.
Amen.
And then we do the mitzvahs above in the heavens. And it's usually just how we treat each other at home. That's all we do is we treat each other better every day.
So true.
And that's how it works.
Yep.
So you at home with your families and at work with your coworkers, you practice real righteousness. as learned in the School of the Magi and in the Master Class. Then that gives you the elevation, because you're dying to your own selfish nature. Then that gives you the elevation to reform when you go out in society or you deal with the world system. If you have changed your way to agree with God's way and walk in His way, that's what brings a change in reformation through judgment of righteousness. That's the only thing that changes things. So, where are we going with this? School of the Magi, this is important for you to know. This was the other thing. You could take the master class again and again and never go cosmic if you don't go through the School of the Magi. It possibly, potentially could happen, but we've never seen it happen yet. Every single person that we have cosmic has gone through the School of the Magi, most of them several times. We have one person that's on the HOD, I believe now, who went through it at least three times, probably more, until literally Jesus showed up, threw him a pair of shoes with the wings on it, and he saw it. And then when he still hesitated, and then I said, put the shoes on, they physically materialized, like visibly, for just a moment in the house.
Amen.
And there's like, all right, okay. So if you do the work and you change your character, heaven will show up with the signs and wonders. Where people go wrong is they chase signs and wonders. I think I saw a moon sign, and isn't that it? And then they message people, is this my sign? Is this my sign? Mm. If you're manifesting that behavior, understand it's not time for you to go cosmic yet.
Truth.
And you don't want to get beat up being a little spirit without the right armor, because they will incinerate you.
That's right.
But if you're in real righteousness, you'll be invincible.
Invincible.
And that's the way it works. So critical foundations. It's basically, School of the Magi is your Malkuth boot camp. How to get to the moon. How to overcome all that's
it's
in
so
the world.
Good. I mean, it's every secret and life hack of eternal Israelite could dream of. I mean, it's priceless revelation of how to escape Babylon the Great and be safe and protected and blessed in what Jesus Christ has provided for us. It's invaluable.
Amen. And so we've got one person there, went through it at least to what I know, at least three times. And my pointer finger
prophet
is going here. And then we have another person who went in the sun. I'm pretty sure that they went through the materials as well. And then we have another, a lot of the women's group, they're making progress even in Malkuth. Some people have ascended a little bit in Malkuth by going through, you know, doing the Torah study, watching the lives, but they actually came up with the schedules. One of the girls used AI to schedule her going through the masterclass. And what they found was you can go through the whole thing in a week, and you break it down into how much you'd have, which articles you would read every day. And I think someone shared that on our Facebook page, so you can check that out in the Facebook group, RLM Facebook group. But basically, you could go through in a week, or let's say you're really busy, do it in 2 weeks. And then you just keep going through it. So if it took one of those people, they went through the School of the Magi at least three times, and now they're cosmic. And then we have two people, transfigured of spirit over the sun, both of whom also went through that material many times. And on top of that, they took the notes, they started practicing it and doing it. So first you absorb it, become a sponge, which means, what do you do with a sponge that's dirty? Wring it out. So we're gonna start with a sponge and wring out everything we think we know about Christianity and how to be good, and clean slate. There's for your clean talk, clean sponge, clean slate. There's our cosmic clean talk for the day. And then you want to get the teaching, which is like your soap, and just get to a fresh cleaning, brand new everything, because it works. So we've got two people who have taken School of the Magi again and again and again until they could go cosmic, and they are transfigured in their spirit above the sun. So then we have 1, 2, 3, 4 people in the whole world that are like that. And we have a couple of other people who are cosmic, and they went cosmic, how? By going through School of the Magi. Now, Brandon had read the posts, but I think that was before they were compiled, but I personally You gotta have some benefit.
I was there on the ground, on the front lines, getting it face to face every single day.
Yeah. So there gotta be some benefit.
I didn't really know what school the Magi was until today, so I apologize for that.
No, it's just there's so many things we deal with every day.
It's been a thousand miles an hour every day, guys, for like 25 years, really my whole life.
It's a lot. Yeah.
This is what you need. School of the Magi is the answer for everyone still in the sands of the earth.
Yep.
You love Jesus. You want the cave of treasures. You just need understanding. You just need some wisdom. This is the wisdom you need.
Yeah. And the point of some of those things is it is really designed to kind of irritate the demonic areas of the nephesh. And so where there could be an irritation, you know, later on you get that intoxication of the Holy Spirit and repentance. But it works. Every single person that we have that is cosmic with circumcisions and fruit, they have all been through it, most of them, multiple times.
Yeah.
And that's the only thing you really need to do to get cosmic. Now, the master class, again, is once you're there, now what do you do? How do you stay in the bounds? But to first go cosmic, if you're not cosmic, you need School of the Magi. And just keep going through it and then practice it, right? First we absorb, we're a sponge. And then we can go to the cleaning, which is the changing, then start living it and really agree in the mind and the heart and the spirit. And if there's something that's irritating or offensive, just work that out with the Lord. Because again, everyone who's gone cosmic so far successfully with circumcisions has done this. They read it, they go through it, they get it. And then, like I said, even one of them, Jesus literally shows up, here's your shoes, come on, it's time to go.
Yeah.
The heaven will show up when you agree. And then once you agree with it, now this is the thing about the
Mass School of the Magi. Apostle Rebekah's epistles to the nations of everything God has done in her in order to help every believer in the world, guys. These are literally the apostles' epistles of the 21st century. Truth anyhow. Mm-hmm.
The powerful thing to me is the evidence that people read it, believe it, and then as soon as they start doing it and practicing it, I've heard of, you know, people will get, you know, raptured into the School of Enoch, things like that. But more importantly, they get circumcision of heart and they go cosmic and it works. And that's the one thing everyone cosmic right now with circumcision has in common is they've all been through the School of the Magi multiple times. Except, like I said, with Brandon, he was there when it was being written. And as we've ascended, we always share with each other revelation.
Yeah.
And I personally have said these things and we go over them together
a lot.
And he's personally a lot, he's like a lot, yeah.
Oh yeah, we revelate all day long,
all the day long, and he shares these things. So, you know, with the things that he's learning and the things that has helped him with me, and so we always iron sharpen iron with each other. And that's the benefit of being, you know, married to someone. If God has given you a spouse, don't waste it, don't squander it. That's not just, you know.
Yeah, I'm super blessed. You know, it's intense how blessed I am to have such an apostle for a wife. And it's no joke. Like, this is a cosmic apostle, like unto Enoch. And I am so blessed to have her in my life. I think for me, the most amazing thing about the School of the Magi, having gone through all of it myself and obeyed it to be in these heights of the ladder of Jesus Christ, is the safety.
Yeah.
This, the safety for the soul, for me, I could cry right now, is the most important thing for the souls that love Jesus in the earth. This will get you safe from the kelapot, because they are birds, they're hungry birds flying overhead that are always looking to eat worms, and the worm is not safe until it's in the cave of treasures. The School of the Magi is the apostolic instruction to get the born-again believer in worm form. We know that's biblical. The metamorphosis of the worm to the butterfly. The butterfly is only possible on the ladder. The worm has to get to the cave of treasures. These are the instructions to get safe, so the birds are not eating the souls of the believers of Jesus Christ anymore, anywhere in the world. To me, that safety is the most important thing. Amen.
Amen. And that's what we want for you. His banner over you is love. And it's safety, it's protection. And I will share this wisdom with you guys watching, those of you who are rising and those who are rising in the future after this is already made and broadcasted. that you're coming back and watching this for your instruction because you've made it this far. I want to say congratulations on making it this far to the 8th and the 9th and to the 10th week. I want you to understand one of my greatest regrets in all of my rising through learning things. You know, sometimes I learn things a hard way as a pioneer. If I'm not sensitive to the voice of God, understand it's always harder to hear the voice of God. And I feel a heavy kavod on this. It's always harder to hear the voice of God when it comes to your own things, your own self, or where you have certain feelings, or where that you're trying to be.
PTSD, wounds and trauma.
Those are the hardest areas to hear. Where it feels like the voice of God is really clear sometimes, and other times it's not as clear, it's because there's noise of a wound or a trauma or something. One of my greatest regrets in all of my rising so far, and right now, if you're watching this, you know, in the future, right now I am, at the time of this video recording, I am in Tiferet of Isaiah of Yetzir of the third heaven. That is Tiferet of the 12th week. And so after 12 weeks of cosmic ascension and what I've learned, some things from revelation, other things the hard way, one of my biggest regrets is not remembering everything in the school of the Magi, especially when it comes to the 10th week. And one of the keys is, and I had a hint, but I didn't quite get the hint. Angel flash over here. Yeah, I got a witness. Thanks for bearing with me. Michael, the long suffering, all these angels, long suffering, you know, with us.
True.
But, anyway, we appreciate it. Thank you. Hey.
Yeah, thank you, angels.
They're banners over us, and the love of the Father for us. And so one of my greatest regrets is not remembering or catching that hint that school of the Magi is really what you need for the 10th week. And I had a hint. It's in my other notes on the little Remarkable app. We have a notepad that somebody had showed us, and this really had come in handy for some of those notes. But you start out in the fear of the Lord in Malkut, and towards the end, it's similar but it's different. You basically finish in the similar but different way you started it. Like it comes full circle, and what that full circle is the Malkut of the Father's house. That's the entirety of the second heavens. Or not Malkut, sorry. It is Malkut, but it's Yesod. It's Shekinah. What does that mean with the whole earth? Because we don't have the first heavens anymore. The old heavens, the old first heavens. So it's Malkut and Yesod Shekinah. You know, that bringing that earthen sphere through, your earthen sphere through the second heavens. So it's that supernal Malkut Shekinah Yesod of the second heavens. It comes full circle when you go from Malkut of Isaiah to the top of the 10th week. And I wish I would have realized that or known that, and I probably could have been saved so much so much trouble from the demonic principalities. So really, school of the Magi, it's valuable when you start, but always hold tight to those things. Everything that's in there, it will come in handy later on. And that's some of the best advice, I think, after all of this rising that I could give anyone, is hold tight to those things and don't let anyone take it from you.
Amen.
Amen.
Rich broadcast. God bless you guys from the myriads of Zion, eternal Israel, of God the Father, Lord Jesus Christ. May this word help you and guide you wherever you are, closer to Him, in the cave of treasures, that you discover the ladder and you begin climbing and you never look back. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
We'll see you tomorrow.
Ladies and gentlemen, esteemed guests and beloved supporters, today I stand before you with a heart filled with gratitude and a vision illuminated by faith. We are gathered here not just as individuals, but as a collective force with a shared purpose: to extend a hand of abundance, to bring forth prosperity, and to manifest the heavenly realities in our world. As we embark on this journey together, I am reminded of the words of Proverbs 3, 9, and 10, which says, "Honor the Lord with your wealth, with the first fruits of all your crops. Then your barns will be filled to overflowing, and your vats will brim over with new wine. It is through our acts of honoring and abundance that we have the opportunity to make a tangible difference in the lives of those around us. RLM TV's missions are not confined by geographical boundaries. From the bustling streets of Florida to the sprawling landscapes of America, from the vibrant city of Nairobi, Kenya, to the farthest reaches of the globe, our mission knows no limits. We are driven by a commitment to serve, a commitment rooted in the teachings of Matthew 6:33, where it is proclaimed, "Seek first His kingdom and His righteousness, and all these things will be given to you as well." With your support, we have the power to manifest abundance, to uplift communities, to sow seeds of prosperity that will yield a harvest of blessings for generations to come. Your generosity is not merely a financial transaction. It is an investment in the heavenly realities, an investment in the embetterment of our world. In the book of Malachi 3:10, we are reminded that bring the whole tithe into the storehouse, that there may be food in my house. Test me in this, says the Lord Almighty, and see if I will not throw open the floodgates of heaven and pour out so much blessing that there will be not enough room to store it. Let us therefore open the floodgates of heaven with our giving, with the overflow of our hearts, and with the promise of a more than enough abundance. Today, I humbly ask you to join us on this noble journey. Your contributions will enable us to continue this vital work, to reach even further, to serve more, and to manifest the heavenly realities around the world. As you open your hearts and your hands in generosity, may you be blessed abundantly, not just in material wealth, but in the riches of glory, in the joy of giving, and in the knowledge that you have co-created in the building of the kingdom of heaven on earth. As our Jewish sages taught, tithing is the holiness available below. And as our Master Jesus the Christ proclaimed, give, and it will be given back to you, good measurements that overflow. Together, let us be the agents of change that our world so desperately needs. Together, let us be the vessels of prosperity that bring forth the heavenly realities. Together, let us make miracles happen. Thank you from the depths of my heart for your unwavering support and your boundless generosity. May the fruitful abundance of heaven overflow in your life. God bless you. Amen.
Yeah.